Well, good afternoon. My name is Jonathan Zittrain. I am an author. How about that? Yay. Feels pretty good. And as an academic author, let me say, please read my book. I don't care if you buy it, just read it. And there may even be, it's a common sentiment, as Bob Darnton has been known to say, the desire to reach readers may be one of the most underestimated forces in the world of knowledge. I would just say in the world. And I partake of that. So I am so pleased to be here today and that you are joining us for an introduction to a new organization, the brainchild of really Pamela Samuelson here, Authors Alliance. We're going to hear about this organization, have a chat about some of the issues that it will plan to be taking up as it begins its existence, and have an opportunity for question and answer as well. And the way we thought we would do it was to have a lead off from Katie Hafner, who's going to have a little presentation. And then, almost as if we are at dinner, but awkwardly only on one side of the table and with no food, I will converse a bit with our panelists, and we'll introduce them one at a time conversationally, and then again open it up to the rest of you. You should be aware that the Panopticon lives. This is being recorded. Foreign governments are probably listening in at this moment as well, so anything you say may well be preserved for the ages. Somebody who would know a lot about that actually is Katie Hafner. Among the books she's written has been the famed When Wizards Stay Up Late from 1996, about the early days of the internet and of hacking. Most recently, Mother, Daughter, Me. I think rated by, is it People magazine, as one of 10 books you must pick up right now. So if you leave the room, we will understand. But if you can wait just a little bit, you can get it afterwards. Katie, your career as a journalist and as an author has been nothing short of spectacular. And we are very lucky to have you here today introducing things for us. So I'm going to turn it over to you. Please welcome Katie Hafner.
So, Jonathan, thank you so much, and thanks to the Berkman Center and to the Office of Scholarly Communications for hosting this. So I represent a very generic author. Hold on, I'm actually going to time myself with my phone because I don't trust myself. Jonathan is going to be asking Pam more about the general goals and areas of focus of the Authors Alliance, but I'm here to tell you one very specific story. So when Pam Samuelson asked me last spring to join the advisory board of the Authors Alliance, I was happy to do it, mostly because I have such respect for Pam and her work, and I always have. But I am such a typical author, it's frightening. I know I sign my contracts, I have no idea what I'm signing. My agent just sends me what I need to know, which is that I have not made my advance back yet. But at the time that Pam got in touch with me, I happened to be going through something that I thought the Authors Alliance might be able to help me with. And I will tell you at the outset that this is a story with a happy ending. In 2008, I published a book that got orphaned in a very classic way. I'll spare you the details, but it was Bloomsbury USA, and I don't know if you know this, but Harry Potter was published by Bloomsbury in the UK, and there's this, I never thought Harry Potter would affect me in any direct way, but it did. And my after the last Harry Potter was published in July 2007, their revenues tanked in the UK, which means that they laid off all these people in the US, which means that my editor, who was the champion of this book, got laid off right before it got published, so I need say no more. And it did come out. It's the story of Glenn, it's self-explanatory. And it got rave reviews, it got a full page in the Times, Kirk has called it the musical version of Seabiscuit, and hey, that's a good thing. And go piano, go. Yeah, there's a tragedy not unlike what happens to the horse. Anyway, so around the time that, oh, and it went into paperback, which is huge. So around the time that Pam got in touch with me about the Authors Alliance, I got email from someone saying that they had been looking for the book and it had gone out of print. And indeed, the print version was nowhere to be found. So I asked my agent, and I hope he's watching this, to look into it, because I was thinking, okay, maybe we could do a rights reversion or something like that. I wasn't really sure, but he was less than helpful, partly because...
Can you just quickly say what a rights reversion is?
So when your book goes out of print and is truly out of print, then you go to the publisher and you say, I'd like the rights back so that I can do with the book what I want. And you can either self-publish it, you can do anything you want, you can make oatmeal out of it, whatever you want, you can do. So I turned to the Authors Alliance and Molly Van Howling, and Michael Wolf and Pam were right on it. And this thing, I don't even know if you guys had started yet. And Molly said, send me your contract. So I have to tell you, I have never used PowerPoint, so I'm super nervous about this. But that's right. So that was my contract. And then my very nice husband helped me do this animation thing. So Molly found... the relevant, I would never have found the relevant paragraph. I don't know if anyone in this room has anyone here really combed through their contract? Oh, you have? Okay. Oh, wait, three people. That's good. So
anybody who is not a lawyer.
Okay. All right. Well, anyway, I assumed I could have the rights back to this book. It's out of print, right? Print out of, right? So, no. This is what it actually meant, was that it's considered in print. So remember, I signed this contract in 2003. It's considered in print if 250 copies of the ebook, that doesn't sound like print to me, but whatever, are sold. So if I sell 249, I'm assuming, I don't know, you guys are lawyers, is that what this means? Then...
I'd have to consult my malpractice insurance before answering in front of everybody a legal question.
Okay. So in any event, I was not happy because it felt like my book was being held. The print version of the book, which wasn't in print, but was kind of still in print, right? Because of the ebook version, I felt like it was in prison. It was being held hostage by the publisher. And so this very cool email, cool as in chili, email came back from George Gibson, who's the publisher of Bloomsbury USA, to my agent, and said, this is what her contract says, you're out of luck. And so I thought, oh my God. So I decided that I needed to impress upon my agent that this was terribly unjust. And so I thought, this must be how my dog feels like when he's stuck in his crate. And there he is. And then so my husband did this animation thing, which I think is pretty great. So then I sent that to my agent, and he just wrote back, that's one smart dog. And so I thought, this isn't working. So I then took a photograph of the book in the cage and sent that to him, and still no reaction. So I sent this photograph to George Gibson at Bloomsbury. I had nothing better to do. And a long sort of position paper about why Bloomsbury should give me my book back. And he engaged, and it was actually great. He said, you know, you've made a really good case. I won't bore you with what my case was, but it was good. And he gave me three options. One was, I just take the rights back and self-publish it. And that felt like a lot of work. Bloomsbury do a small reprint, or Bloomsbury do like an on-demand thing, which sounded like the best option. So I decided to go for that. And I got a whole lot of coaching from the people at the Authors Alliance, thank God, because I wouldn't have been able to sort of figure it all out without them. And that is my personal story. It's kind of a nice way to kick this off. And we can take it from there, and I will take the picture of the book in the cage off.
Thank you so much, Katie. All right, so that's a wonderful story. It does have some aspects, you may think of an infomercial. It's like, I never knew. That could help me as well. But it is an uncompensated endorsement, And we should even be clear, Authors Alliance is a not-for-profit, nonprofit organization. In fact, to learn more about it, Pam, we should naturally turn to you. Pam, you're a doubly appointed professor at the Information School at Berkeley and in law. Your work spans from the high theory of copyright, intellectual property, other topics into practice and into clinical work and teaching. Would love to hear from you a kind of narrative. How did Authors Alliance come about?
So I felt that many people I knew and many people I didn't know were mystified by copyright and mystified by contracts with publishers. And I thought, boy, there's a real opportunity here to speak in a very clear and straightforward way about what are your ownership rights as a matter of copyright law, what are the options that you have in exercising those rights, what kinds of things are commonly in contracts, what kinds of things to watch out for. It seemed to me that there was a real need for an organization that would act on behalf of authors who really want their work to be widely available. Now, I am not going to sit here and say, oh, it's only academics who care about that, because I think everybody who writes cares about getting their work out broadly. And there are times when the best way to make your work available is to find the right publisher who will not only help you curate the book, but also to promote it. Promotion is something that some people do well and some people don't do well. But I would say that the kind of the what I call the inward-facing function of the Authors Alliance is really to listen to authors, to find out what it is that are impediments to achieving the kind of dissemination goals that you have, and then help people overcome them. So it has a kind of forward-looking approach. So we're trying to work with people about what should you look for if you're in negotiation with a publisher? What kind of contract terms to try to insist on? What kind of contract terms perhaps to resist? And then for people who've already assigned their rights in the past, to empower people to feel like you can do something to get them back if your dissemination goals are not really being realized. So we worked with Katie and we worked with Bob Darnton on some rights reversions, and I think that we're in the process of putting together a kind of toolkit to do that. I also think that there's a good idea to have what I call a kind of public-facing mission for something like the Authors Alliance, and by that I mean what is copyright doing for authors and what is it not doing for authors? How could we improve copyright law in a way that would make make more sense for authors, that would improve their lives, and then what can we do to influence courts to the extent that there are issues that are pending in the courts. That's, I think, in a nutshell, yep, at least some of the things that we're kind of up to.
That's great. That's a lot to get us started. And the first is really, as you're describing it, a kind of tactical set of assistance to authors and writers, if those are two different categories. I guess some might identify as one versus the other. I'm not sure. And the second is more public policy oriented within the larger sphere, how these things come together. It might make sense to turn to at least two authors already on our panel, and I'm thinking of Rachel Cohen and Sophia Roosth, who come at it maybe from slightly different fields of writing. Rachel, you are, I think fair to say you are a writer, and you teach on creative writing, and maybe you can also say, is there a difference between being a writer and an author?
No.
Okay, good. That saves us 15 minutes, because we were going to have to really run that down if there was going to be a distinction. But you're also a writer about writers.
Yes, that's right.
So I'd love to hear a little bit about that. And then I'm curious if you share Katie's description. Katie's been published. How many books have you written, Katie?
Six.
Six books. Proudly, never read a single contract. Yeah. And I'm curious if it's the same phenomenon when that stage comes of actually having a publisher ready to roll. You sort of just sign on the dotted line, or how does that work? So love to hear about that.
All right. Well, those are. I was hoping to go later in the panel because I feel I'm less versed in the copyright issues, but I'm glad to say what I can say from my own experience. I've only written two books, but I have to say I read the contracts very carefully. Uh-huh. And was quite aware of what the conditions were for. But maybe that's because I'm of a legalistic turn of mind. And they're both in print. So I haven't had the experience of losing a book in the way that is something that I know Authors Alliance is helpful with. And I think one of the things that I'm really interested in is, I know, of course, many people who have, because virtually everybody goes through that experience at some point in their career, that a book seems to evaporate somehow into a world of...
And this is what Katie was referring to as, I guess we now call it, in the crate.
Yeah.
Right. But not a form of training. It isn't even really for the dog a form of training,
yes.
So it's a good metaphor. Or what we also call orphan works or orphaned works, which is to say not available to the public through the publisher, and yet there's nothing the author is privileged to do about it.
Exactly.
Because the rights have not reverted.
And this happens a lot, especially because there are many... many different publishing houses eating other publishing houses and some imploding, and then it's unclear what happens to the rights when...
This sounds like a mortgage crisis, right? It's like, yeah. TD Bank has your mortgage now. Yes.
Right, so exactly. It is like that. And so I have friends who, you know, with short story collections that they can't get back, or where they wanted to have an online edition of them and weren't able to,
yes.
just literally weren't able to find... who they were supposed to get permission from.
So yes.
I think those things are very common, and I'm concerned about them. I think the writers who I write about are, sometimes they're people like Mark Twain, who was very involved in copyright law and is very interested in writers getting to hold on to the proceeds of their imagination. But I guess one thing that I thought about talking about here, just to add into the mix, is something that I think is also of great interest to writers about this new world, which is not necessarily a copyright issue, but a literary issue, which is what are writers and readers going to be like in the future, and what kind of reader are you writing for if you're gradually thinking that your work is going to be more and more online or on Kindles or in other kinds of media. I know that my own growing up as a reader is tactile. It's the page, and my memory for books is on the page. But my students, that's not the case. And so I think there's a real generational issue about what literary work is becoming and how to think about writing for these new media that comes along with these legal and ownership kinds of questions. And I'm happy to say more about that if there's...
Well, I'm just curious, and it seems great that you're going first, despite your... and you can go last as well.
Okay.
We can come back around. But I think it's very interesting when you talk about writing for new media and for new forms and even new readers.
Mm-hmm.
So do you have, for instance, something you're working on right now that might be different than it would have been if you were starting it 5 or 10 years ago, that you're trying to be cognizant of that?
Sure.
What is that like?
Yeah, I could give a few different examples. I wrote a piece for The New Yorker a couple of years ago that was about this art connoisseur, Bernard Berenson. The online version of the piece had a wonderful kind of graphic where you could see two paintings. One was a forgery and the other was a real painting. And I had tried in my piece to describe how to distinguish between the forgery and the real painting. But in the print version, those pictures did not appear, and you couldn't really tell that well in a print version. Mm. But in the electronic version, you could go back and forth between the two of them. People who read the Kindle version came away with a very in-depth understanding of connoisseurship that people who read the print version didn't have.
Mm.
And I never expected to be an advocate for Kindle reading of my pieces, you know, but
because of your commitment to the physically printed page.
Yes, exactly, because
right.
I love the page. But in that instance, the subtlety of the point was really made in the electronic version. And I've been keeping a notebook online about paintings, and I've been finding that I go to museums and I take detailed photographs with my iPhone. I used to hate people who went to museums and took pictures with their iPhones.
But now you are one.
One of them, sadly. You can explain a lot about a painting online from being able to show in magnification what's happening that you can't do just in writing alone. And so I find that I'm writing these kind of hybrid pieces which are much more dependent on illustration.
Yes.
And I think the visual is entering the literary in a really profound way for all of us.
Yes.
And that seems one aspect of it.
Maybe it means writers are becoming authors. I'm not going to let this go, this distinction, but thank you.
Yeah.
So Sophia, over to you, having had now fair warning. I guess in academia, the gears turn a little more slowly unless one's field is about new media and new forms of presentation. You've just completed a book on synthetic biology. I don't know, is it actually out the door?
It's out the door, although, like you said, the gears move slowly, so I won't actually have a physical copy to hold in my hand until next year.
Mm-hmm. Aha. Well, nothing will happen in the field of synthetic biology in the intervening years, so you'll be fine. But I am curious, your experience as an academic, writing a book first, were you moved to write a book, or were you told to write a book? That's a sort of opening question. Mm-hmm. And a second, when you found yourself going from the hunter to the hunted, you're looking for a publisher and now you've got one and they send you a contract, I'm curious what happens next.
Well, I mean, the answer to your first question is really easy. I was moved to write a book because I had a really good story and I wanted a lot of people to know what that story was. So I wanted to reach as wide a readership as possible and as diverse a one as possible.
Great.
But that being said, the story I have is actually, it's sort of a story of failure, and it has to do with the constraints that are placed on academic authors. So without going into too much detail about synthetic biology, the biologists that I wrote about were very committed to the free software movement. They came out of the Computer Science and Artificial Intelligence Laboratory at MIT. And so they espoused an open science approach to their research. And because of that, I wanted to allow my book to have some form of open access attached to it. But that being said, there are very few presses that count toward my promotion as a latter faculty member. So I went to the most prestigious press in my field. I submitted a proposal for the book and received an advance contract, and then once I received the advance contract, I wanted to negotiate for a Creative Commons attribution non-commercial share-alike license. So I wanted to have the book available online for free. And I made two arguments to the press. The first was what I already said, which was that this is in my best interest because I'll have a wider readership, and I'll be able to have the book read by more students, it'll be available in classes, and that's a good thing. And I said it was also better for the press because they could think of this as sort of like an online bookstore. People can peruse the book, and even if 1% of the people who peruse the book actually buys it, then that's good for the press, right? And the press said, no, absolutely not, that it was non-negotiable. They said that the ebook is an important addition for them, and that sales of the ebook would then offset the cost of hardcover and paperback copies of the book.
And you felt like you couldn't exactly shop it around. This gets back to my sort of, were you moved to write a book or told to write a book? You were moved to write a book, but you were, quote unquote, by the system told where the book would go if you could only get it in the door.
Yeah, absolutely. So I've been told that there are 7 academic presses that count for promotion.
Wow, this is a great twist on the George Carlin 7 dirty words. You can say the 7 academic, we can reel them all off at once and they'll be bleeped on the,
I won't list them. And then within my discipline, there are 2 or 3 that are considered high prestige. So the press that I went to has a monopoly on prestige. And as someone who wants to keep my job for the foreseeable future, I didn't really have any room to negotiate.
So can I, let's just put for a moment a bookmark, and we will return to it in this quite amazing story, because we happen to have with us at least 2 representatives of presses. So let me just quickly turn to Ellen Faran of the MIT Press. I don't know if you're one of the 7 or not.
You are.
Okay. And your answer.
I'm sticking around if I'm not.
Right. Well. Your answer to my question may depend on whether you're on the list, because my question is, Does this make any sense? When you hear an author speaking this way, does it warm your heart or chill your bones?
It's a conversation that we do have quite frequently these days, and I'm happy to have it.
But you're talking about the Creative Commons conversation.
Yeah.
No, I want to just go back a step and ask about the idea that there's the Big Seven. And if you don't publish your book as one of the Big Seven, I guess it's farewell to your academic career kind of thing, or bad news. And if you can get it there, boom, you're in.
I think that this whole topic of credentialing and the requirements for tenure and promotion involving traditional hardcover print publication is a huge factor in our landscape, in what's going on now and why it's hard to move forward. I've said before on other occasions that it seems to me that every aspect of scholarly communication is in rapid, shifting, changing, transforming mode, except the tenure committee.
So if you just had three or four tweet-length sort of things you could say to a tenure committee from your seat directing the MIT Press, what would it be?
Loosen up.
I was thinking get a life, but I think that's the judges will take that as a hit. And let me just, Alison, turn to you real quick. Alison Mudditt, a publisher. You've been, I think, as Ellen has been, in both non-academic and academic publishing.
That's right. Yes.
Currently with the USC Press, is that right?
University of California
Press. University of California Press. So just curious for your view on this this issue about the primacy of certain presses as you're hearing it from an academic who's got marching orders, which in turn influence the sort of negotiation she can do, not over picayune terms that, whatever, we don't need to read the contract so much, but over can a classroom easily get to that fragment of Sophia's book, or do they have to go buy the ebook kind of thing?
Yeah. No, I mean, it's absolutely the case, and I think it's not just seven presses. I think it depends heavily on the field in which you're in. So there's a pecking order of presses for each academic field. But beyond that, there is also a primacy about the form of publication, and for us, that is coming up just as much as the press itself. So particularly in the humanities, where different forms of digital scholarship are becoming increasingly common, the gold standard in the humanities is still the print book. And yet there are an increasing number of faculty who are doing research that cannot be reproduced purely in print form.
Right down to the comparison of works of art to figure out
the imposter. Or those that start to include film, video, you know, other kinds of work. And that's before you get into sort of true digital humanities projects that are often created with a collaborative team.
Yes.
Then you get into the whole issue of how you credential people on work that isn't sort of unique to themselves.
Yes.
We're actually about to launch an open access monograph program at UC Press. So one of the things I've been doing is spending a lot of time out on campuses over the last 6 months talking to chairs of promotion and tenure committees, vice provost for academic personnel. I had a meeting with the vice provost for academic personnel here this morning to talk about these kinds of issues and how different campuses are starting to address them.
And what do you hear when you talk to them? Are they open access curious?
It really varies. There are many campuses who, you know, UCLA, for example, who are incredibly savvy about this. You talk to deans and administrators, they get it, they understand why it's beneficial. As long as it's peer-reviewed, the format doesn't seem to matter. In many cases, where you get resistance is when you get down to departmental level, and there are certain departments that are more conservative than others, and I'm sure we could all point to them. Then you get to other institutions, and I think this is one of them, where there is a more conservative standard there, and there can afford to be. I mean, many of the faculty here have done very well in the current system, and given that many of them are still the ones that people the tenure committees, it's actually, from the conversations I've had, probably harder somewhere like this, and it is on one of the UC campuses.
Okay, well, thank you. This was still a bookmark from Sophia's tale. It sounds like you've gotten acknowledgement of this chapter of the tale, but please keep telling us how you've experienced the publishing of your book and the dealing with the contract. Was that was one of your biggies, was the open access?
I mean, the other stuff was minor, and I found it interesting, in fact, that that was the only thing on which the press refused to budge, was this request for the share-alike license.
And hearing that other presses maybe do it, other presses are starting a program, not persuasive.
Well, I mean, I brought a list to my acquisitions editor and, you know, mentioned your book. I mentioned Chris Kelty's Two Bits, Ian Condry, Hip Hop Japan, Annalie Newitz's book, Pretend We're Dead. You know, there are lots of examples of different versions of open access or copyleft sort of negotiations that have been made with presses. And so Chicago said, well, we've never done that before. And I said, that's great. I'll be your guinea pig. Let me be the first one, and we'll see how it goes. And there was just, it wasn't even a negotiation, because it was something that they didn't want to do. And
was there another publisher vying for your book?
Yes, there were a few.
And it's just, you didn't feel you could... You could take it, because you'd lose that imprint.
That's right.
Got it. Mark Fisher, let's turn to you. Lawyers were mentioned within 5 minutes of convening our panel by Katie, and we have a lawyer on the panel, not the only one, given Pam's presence. But Mark, tell us a little bit about your practice and your sense of the change in the field over the years. And when you see a young author coming in with that first book contract, how often can any redlining result in a change, or is it, this is my favorite publisher, it's who I want to go with?
Oh, well, thanks, Jonathan. I think you're a lawyer, too, last I checked.
You take that back.
those are fighting words. Hi, I practice media and entertainment law, and I work in a lot of media, and I have a long history with open source and open science as well, and I do co-write a book, Pearlie Williams and Fisher on publishing law for Walters Kluwer, so I have a little sense of reading my own contracts. To answer Jonathan's question is that most publishers, and I say most, not all, will encourage and permit changes. There are so many different constituencies, whether it's STM, scientific, technical, medical, where reputation may be more important than money. Money's nice. Trade, children's, and the rapid changes where everyone sees all content or hears all content on the same screen and same speakers is a fundamental change, because viewers and users, whatever we are getting the content of differing trade customs on the same device, which is really very, very interesting. There are lots and lots of old publishing houses that seem to be family run that will say, if you change a comma, you're satanic, and we will not have such kind of people at our house. But other than that kind of stereotype, which is very true, most publishers will listen to reasonable comments.
And do you think of academic publishers, especially the unnamed seven, as if they are family publishers in this example?
No, most of them will listen to reasonable comments. Obviously, the most important word in the entertainment and publishing business is leverage. And if you're the young startup author who has no other offers, you don't have much leverage. But publishers will always talk. And if you have an agent or a lawyer who's dealt with the house before, you know each other, and there are forms that they know you will accept and don't accept. So that can be an advantage of using an agent or someone else who's had some experience with the house, because you can say, well, come on, you always give me that reversion clause. You can't tell me that our standard version clause, which means the book is never out of print.
Yes.
Because online is forever. You can say, why? Don't tell me you never give that. I know you give that.
So then let me ask you quite directly, given that you've got people at the table interested in an economy of scale, producing advice for authors that might be free as the air to breathe, available on the website to say, here is what's typical, here's what's not, here's some template language you could use to edit a contract. Apart from the fact that I suppose in some respect it could eat your lunch or your appetizer, because people could just consult the website rather than hiring a bespoke attorney, what advice would you give to such a venture? Is there enough, is there an 80% that is sort of shared in common across many of these transactions that it's amenable to this form of shared advice?
Oh, very much so. I think, more information is best. Publishing contracts are relatively simple compared to other media. Music contracts are often 80 pages and really, really difficult. TV agreements can be very difficult. Motion picture agreements, still harder. You know, royalties, for example, are relatively simple. They're generally based on the list price of the book, in trade at least. That's not a hard concept compared to other media. And so everyone should encourage talking to other authors, talking to agents. I know you talk to various people, including Jonathan. And that's just fabulous. The more, the better.
And a kind of gestalt-y question, 20 years from now, is it pretty much going to be the same configuration for the form of the monograph for the book? There'll be the publishing houses, whether on the academic or the trade side. You write your monograph, you get a contract, it gets published, and hopefully the editors don't get laid off the week before it comes out.
Do you mean in STM or in...
No, I mean broadly speaking. I mean, so far, for instance, we've only been talking about books, well, in part because books, really, when you think of authorship, there's something that captures the imagination with a book, even in 2014.
Well, if one looks at past as prologue, the changes in the last 5 years with Amazon Online, to go 20 years is science fiction, except to say I think that we'll find more and more convergence of transactions among different media, and that there will be less distinctions of trade custom. And so some of the kinds of things we're talking about today will swap back and forth with other industries. Already seen it, for example, subscription agreements, this kind of Spotify for books.
Yes.
We're now seeing clauses in book contracts that look a little like that. And of course, in the record industry, having spent a lot of time in the music industry, labels will say, we can use all of your content based on a fraction of the content. They won't tell you that that fraction will include content for which they don't pay royalties, or public domain content, thus reducing your take. Book publishers will learn that too. So I think you'll see much more convergence, to the extent anyone could possibly make an accurate prediction about 20 years from now in this industry.
Got it. Bob Darnton, let's turn to you. If there were a centerpiece at the table, you would be awarded it to take home at the end, because Bob just got off a flight, having boarded the flight. When did you board it?
4 this morning.
At 4 this morning. But that was 4 this morning
in Bologna.
Bologna time. And flew here specifically to be able to be on the panel. So, Bob, like, thank you for coming today. And in some ways, you are a dean of this space, of the American literary scene, of the form and evolution of the book, of communications. And when it works and when it's censored, these are all things that you take up in your many posts, including as librarian. So I kind of just want to invite you to weigh in even on what you've heard so far and what you might be reacting to.
Well, I'm delighted to be here. There's a kind of true confessions quality to our discussion so far.
It is AA, Authors Alliance.
That's right. So maybe I should make my confession.
Yes.
I mean, I've published a fair number of books, but the first one I published was published by the Harvard University Press in 1968. It's almost 50 years old, and it's still in print. I love the Harvard University Press. They did a great job with that book. My income from it is not big.
You're not retiring yet.
I make enough money from this in-print book to take my wife out to dinner once every 2 years.
But she can get the apple pie with that.
No, she has to pay her half of the dinner.
I see. Too bad. Yes.
So
happy meal.
My approach to this is somewhat different from the others, because unlike Katie and so on, I don't depend on my pen or computer for a living. I'm an academic. I get a professor's salary. And I basically write to communicate such knowledge as I have to communicate. So my approach to the general discussion really is, how can we academics and other authors best realize our goal of communicating knowledge? Mm. Now, there's a lot of information about the book market and so on, and how it's changed recently. If you're writing light fiction, if your book doesn't sell in the first 2 or 3 weeks, it's dead. Most books, not necessarily light fiction, but interesting books, die after a few months or a year or two. The commercial life of a book is very limited. So you, the author, whether you're an academic author or not, you're not going to make much money, if any, from the book you wrote. And the factor of prestige and so on, I think we've rightly stressed. So here I was, not making much money from that book, or the next one I published with a Harvard University Press. And my engagement has to this cause, the Authors Alliance, thanks to Pam, is also linked with the Digital Public Library of America and the general problem of copyright. So as most of you know, all books published after 1964 are not in the public domain. Most books published after 1932 are not in the public domain. Most 20th century literature is outside of the public domain, and therefore the Digital Public Library of America cannot make them available free of charge to the general citizenry. Now, I see Jonathan Hulbert here. He can tell us a lot more about that. He's been very deeply involved in this, and so have Pam and others. But I see this as a crime and a shame. I think that these books, which are not bringing in money to their authors, should be made available. How can we do it? The answer is, in part, the Authors Alliance. So I made the first two books I published available free of charge with the agreement of the Harvard University Press. And I actually have the language here, which I'll spare you. But actually, Harvard was very generous about agreeing to do this, not because they were going to lose a lot of revenue from these two non-selling books, but because publishers have an interest in the long tail, in their backlist. This is to them their often most important asset. I mean, I defer to the professionals here. So I could imagine that Harvard would have hesitated to say, well, we don't make any money from this book, but we want to keep it in whatever kind of package we will make available for sale. And Harvard did not. They were very, I thought, public-spirited about it. So I have a Creative Commons license. It's the books it has two qualities, attribution and non-commercial use. Now, the non-commercial aspect of the Creative Commons license is important for publishers, I believe, because their objection could be that someone else would pick this book up off the internet and repackage it and sell it and so on. So my advice would be for those of you who have a book out but it hasn't been selling for some time, consider turning over to the Authors Alliance the use of your rights with the agreement of your publisher, and then you will get what you want, which is, as you quoted me earlier, to have readers. Once the commercial life of your book is exhausted and it's no longer selling, what else do you want? You want readers. And that means you don't want it to sit on a remote shelf in some library where a handful of people will read it, but put it online. We know that that's a great way to spread knowledge. So that's my take on the subject.
Thank you very much. Pam, maybe this puts it back to you. And there's an interesting bookend between Sophia's tale and Bob's tale, both of whom sought Creative Commons non-commercial licenses with different results. Bob's tale more agrees with Mark's experience in how willing publishers might be. And I'm curious first about Bob's intriguing mention of just assign your rights over to Authors Alliance, no salesman will visit. Would love to hear more about that plan and what that's about. And also, I suppose, there was allusion really to the Google Books settlement within Bob's remarks. And That probably plays some backstory in the creation of Authors Alliance, especially given your active role in that ongoing litigation is almost too kind a word to describe that vortex of endless, fill in the noun with Mad Libs. So I invite you, if you want to weigh in on those things.
So our experience is working with Katie and also with Bob on getting rights reversions has really led us to think about how we can develop a kind of toolkit to enable authors more generally to kind of have a decision tree. So that decision tree will include, do you have your contract? Do you know where it is, what it says? Does it have a reversion clause in it? What are the standards for reversion? And then even if you don't have a reversion clause, or even if your reversion clause isn't quite satisfied in the way that that both Bob and Katie were referring to, what do you want to do with your book that's different from what's going on now? And here are some options. Some of those options will be for people who want to make another arrangement with another publisher. Some of it may be to make it open access or to make it public domain. And we at Authors Alliance are working on an agreement. So we're working with Harvard University Press on developing an agreement, and we'll make that agreement available online so that people can see kind of what it might look like. So we're in conversation with HathiTrust, the digital library at the University of Michigan, and for books that are going to be Creative Commons licensed, HathiTrust will actually make them available through the HathiTrust corpus, and that is something that will then mean that the books are going to be available. And also, one of the advantages of HathiTrust is that you can do a search across a corpus of 10 million books and find out what are relevant books, and that's going to mean that your books are findable in ways that they might not otherwise be findable, and that's, I think, a great benefit. And then to the extent that the things are Creative Commons, we've been able to make an arrangement to get rights reversions, then Authors Alliance will work with HathiTrust to essentially make that transition happen so that that more books can be available on open access basis when that's what their authors want.
And I'm gathering that for somebody like HathiTrust, it might be easier administratively to have all of these rights where they have to repose somewhere being, say, with Authors Alliance, essentially
right.
in trust for the authors
we'll be a
rather than
of those kinds of agreements, and they'll be able to deal with us. And so it's one of those things that will make it more efficient
yep.
to try to do that. So our initial toolkit, I think, is going to be available by late November, maybe early December. So we're
yes.
looking to roll that out, and we're happy to get feedback from people, but what we're trying to do is just kind of offer what the option space
yes.
looks like, because I think part of the thing is that if people don't know what their contracts say, like Katie, I don't want to read it, or it's too convoluted, then people aren't taking
yes.
some initiative that they might actually want to take. And so part of this is kind of, again, author empowerment is what the Authors Alliance is really
yes.
about. And this is, what are your goals? How can we help you achieve it? And then how can we think about developing information resources that can be used by a variety of people? Because doing this on a kind of one-off basis isn't really scalable.
Yes.
So looking for ways to try to make it into a more scalable operation is a good thing. And we've actually found in the course of doing some research about this that there are authors of science fiction and other types of independent works, they've been able to get some rights reversion, and they've given us some good advice that we can put in. And one of the things that we'll have on our website when this launches is some stories from people who managed to do rights reversion, and then some advice that we got from them about how to approach your publisher.
Yes.
What kinds of stories to tell, what might your publisher be worried about,
yes.
how can you address that kind of thing, and that seems to me to be something that will be beneficial to authors and won't be harmful to publishers. And so learning Great. To have a constructive dialogue, I think, is good.
Great. I'm anxious to open it up to the audience, but wanted to give you another opportunity if you want to say anything about Google Books.
So Google Books settlement was one thing that everybody kind of got, oh my God, a universal digital library, what a great idea. But the settlement had some problems. So even though I shared an enthusiasm for the ultimate goal, I had to say I was really not very happy with the settlement for a bunch of reasons. And I was glad that when the Judge Chin rejected it. But like Bob, I found myself to be inspired by the idea of it. And one of the things about this kind of Authors Alliance toolkit to get rights reversions is so that we can try to not have exactly what would have been there, but something in that neighborhood. And we'll also be weighing in on Orphan Works issues so that when you can't find the author of a work, isn't it fair use to be able to make it available? Yes. Those kinds of issues are things that I think feed into that larger vision.
There's that connection again between the tactical advice to individual authors and then moving it into policy. I should say, I know that the Authors Guild had been one of the parties to the settlement and therefore was favoring it. When Authors Alliance was announced, I don't know if the Guild had an official response, you may remember, but it appeared to be, at least from its leadership, a sort of autoimmune reaction akin to severe hives. And I'm just curious just to map that out a little bit, and also, how many people in the room consider themselves authors, or authors of some kind? This is an author-heavy room, I think. Let the record show about, 40% of the hands went up. So if they're thinking, it's an agent calling, wanting to buy the book. I haven't seen a flip phone in 5 years. Anyway, people may be wondering, should I be, or I am a member of the Authors Guild? Is it redundant to be also a member of Authors Alliance? How does this relate? Am I stepping into anything, like a fight between mom and dad, by somehow making a choice between Authors Alliance versus Authors Guild, or both? Curious, just anything you want to say about that?
Yeah, so the initial reaction of the Authors Guild to the formation of the Authors Alliance was pretty hostile. TJ Styles spent an hour and a half interviewing my co-founder, Molly Van Howling, and then wrote a fictional version of what she actually said. So it was the...
it's a form of storytelling.
Yeah, so I said, you know, for somebody who's a well-known nonfiction writer, I was really surprised that you took up fiction when it came to talking about the Authors Alliance, because they said
I'm sure that smoothed things over.
I figured he was a lost cause, but we have been having exchanges with other people in the Authors Guild. Quite a number of our members are members of both organizations. I'm looking forward to finding issues on which we can work together, because it's the case that the Authors Guild does some things for its members, like offering insurance, that we're not going to be able to do. And the Authors Guild has some membership requirements that many people who consider themselves authors don't meet, or some people who are authors, even who make money and could qualify as Authors Guild members, don't like some of the things that they've done. So I think within their membership, there's probably at least a few, and I know some of them, who would not have recommended bringing the lawsuits against HathiTrust and against Google, but especially against HathiTrust. I mean, honestly, they were trying to preserve their books and make the books readable by print disabled people. I mean, how can you...
HathiTrust, that is.
Yes, HathiTrust is trying to do that, and the Authors Guild are trying to stop them from preserving their books and making books readable by print disabled people. It's like, really?
the negative campaign ad writes itself. But Bob, you wanted to jump in for a moment, and then I'm going to go on the hunt for questions.
A quick comment. I mean, the Authors Guild may not be very well known to many of you. Its president is a former congressman from Maine, I think. He's a lobbyist. That's basically what their function is. And they tend to represent highly commercial, highly visible authors. But they have a division within their own ranks. And I think that it's very unclear what the future of the Authors Guild will be. But they were so bloody-minded, especially in opposing the idea that HathiTrust should make available books to the visually impaired people. They were so
uncharitable that
a lot of their members are now questioning the leadership, and rightly questioning the leadership of the Authors Guild, whereas the Authors Alliance is not even remotely like that. The Authors Alliance is trying to help authors, but it's not a lobbying organization.
So there's definitely a landscape here. Katie is looking like she's wanting to say something. I'm going to find a question while you do, Katie.
Really quickly, when A Romance on Three Legs came out, Brewster Kahle immediately asked me whether I would donate the book for visually impaired.
Brewster, founder of the Internet
Archive.
Founder
of the Internet Archive. And I said, of course. I didn't read the contract, so I don't know if I was allowed to do that. But I just.
Katie, have we got a deal for you after the panel?
But it made all the sense in the world, so of course,
Yes. Got it. We should also say, in compositing the panel, we were able to round out a very complete panel. We're going to hear from more of them during Q&A. We did reach out to several members of the Authors Guild in a sort of non-Fox 25 News at 10, might we ambush you kind of way, and a non-that way. And I think they genuinely, some of them were very interested, and scheduling meant they couldn't. And I think we would all be better to allow what they have to say, and I'm sure we will be hearing it. Yes, sir, feel free to introduce yourself. And
my name is Daniel Dern. Hi, Jonathan. I haven't seen you since you were there Bruce Schneier at some other event. As someone who's been writing for a living for decades, who is a member of a varying mix of writers' organizations for authors, for journalists, and for this and that, I'm curious whether the Alliance is trying to work laterally, because I know from personal experience that, say, the Science Fiction Writers of America, in particular, has been working on copyright issues and contracts for decades when they're not squabbling over awards and membership or other petty things. And so I know that a lot of these wheels have been invented and are in motion.
Yes.
Are you aware of them? Are you looking to share resources and, you know,
got it,
et cetera, et cetera?
So it was one of the reasons that we chose the name Authors Alliance, because we want to work with other organizations. So we have been building networks, starting to build networks. We only launched in May, so we have actually a ways to go to work with many other organizations, but we have very open attitude about sort of finding alliances where we can. And I know that a couple of weeks ago, Molly was a speaker at a conference that Columbia University held about making copyright work for authors, and many of the issues that came up from the different representative of authors' organizations that spoke at that conference were things that were already on our reform agenda. So things like a small claims court disputes resolution rather than having to go to federal court.
These are disputes between publishers and authors, most typically?
Anybody. A lot of the call for small claims court adjudication, something like that, is that authors who, let's say, regularly license this particular work for $1,000 or $1,500, if somebody infringes, you'd spend $1,000 just talking to a lawyer before you could possibly then.
I see. So it's almost a form of arbitration. You'd ask a would-be infringer to submit to that process rather than maybe face a federal.
The Copyright Office has been looking into it. It was one of the recommendations of a Copyright Principles Project that I worked on a couple of years ago with copyright professionals. And it's one of the things that the Authors Alliance will be working toward. But what I'm saying is that the people from the organizations that were represented at the Columbia Conference were talking about issues and things that that groups could do, and they're already in harmony with some of the things that we put forward.
Great. Another question, way in the back.
Yes, hi. Good afternoon. My name is Chris Keneally. I was a freelance journalist and a book author for many years, and now work at Copyright Clearance Center on author relations programs. And the subject of author empowerment has come up, and I'm curious for anybody on the panel to tell me about how they feel self-publication, self-publishing, the revolution in self-publishing is going to change this discussion, because it will shift from being a author versus publisher discussion to one where the author, at least nominally, is in charge. Now, those deals will be with Amazon, they'll be with Smashwords, they'll be with others, but it will not be the same discussion. Someone asked Mark about what life is going to be like 20 years from now. Life is already quite different for many of those authors.
Great, thank you very much, Chris. I'd love to work outward from the publishers back into our authors. So maybe Alison, especially bringing to bear, it sounds like the academic presses may be the last one to turn the lights off after the party's over, should the party end, because we have the tenure committees continuing to provide the refreshments. But speaking from your background in commercial and trade publishing, when you look at something that is a lot of self-publishing able to go on, whether it's directly through a blog or more commonly maybe, Amazon says, do a Kindle single with us.
Right.
I guess definitionally it makes them a publisher, but it doesn't have the same feel to it. How do you think the publishers are thinking about that? Is that a threat?
I think it is in some cases, and I think it really depends on the author and the book. So if we're talking about scholarly monographs, one of the primary reasons to publish a scholarly monograph is, as we've heard, they don't make money. The real reason is for credentialing. And so publishing with a recognized university press in your field is what you have to do.
Right.
So unless the faculty review process starts to change, I think that piece kind of largely stays in place.
That'll be a while. We get that.
That will be a while.
But for the next Stephen King book, or the little Stephen King book, the as yet unrecognized Stephen King.
Right. Well, I think for the Stephen King book, it's pretty straightforward. And even when you think about academic authors for the next Stephen Pinker book, it's very possible. Those are authors who already have a recognized name. They have an audience. One of the key things that a publisher brings in the trade sense is publicity, marketing, sales. If you're Stephen King, you can manage without that if your book is on Amazon, where, you know, for most of us, Amazon is 40%+ of our book sales at this point.
Yeah.
For the author who's starting out, who doesn't have a recognized audience, I think it's a lot more challenge without the support that a good publisher will provide.
So if an author were coming to a clueless person like me and saying, I'd love some advice about, I've written this thing, I think it's great, should I put it on out through Amazon and then see if it can catch fire through Twitter and other forms of point, or should I go to a publisher and try to get that advance? If I were to say, the publisher's gonna take whatever it is, 80, 85% of the royalties, they'll maybe give you an advance if you're lucky, the contract's gonna be kind of a mess, they're throwing a ton of pasta at the ceiling, and if you don't stick, bye-bye. Why not just put it out there and see what happens? Am I wrong in giving that person that advice?
Not necessarily. I mean, I think it really depends on the book, the author, and what the author is trying to achieve. And that's true.
Stardom and lots of money.
Yeah, and I mean, if you're not recognized, I think that's potentially more challenging.
Yes.
Again, I would, you know, if you go back to scholarly monographs for a moment, and when you talk about open access there, I mean, again, I think it's a different driving force. So the real difference between the current model and the open access model for monographs is around how you cover the cost of publication. Mm. It's not about print versus digital or peer review versus unpeer reviewed. Those are all kind of confused with it. But essentially, it's about how you cover those costs of initial publication. And I think at the end of the day, the strongest argument comes back to readership. The current model allows your book to sit in maybe 300 or 400 libraries who can still afford to buy it versus an open access model that potentially puts it out there for anybody who's interested in it. Now, a lot of these books are still fairly specialized and they're not going to suddenly be read by hundreds of thousands of people, but it gives them an opportunity to find their own life in the world in a way that the current model doesn't.
Bob, you were going to say?
Well, I certainly agree that the role of publishers as gatekeepers, as editors, as people who market books and so on, that those skills are crucial and will continue. But I think the point about self-publishing is crucial. Now, my statistics are probably wrong, but I believe there were 200,000 self-published books last year. There you are. So that's more.
And that
books.
Doesn't include computer-generated books, which there's several million.
My point is simply this: it's not all about glory and money.
Yes.
The people who publish books themselves vary tremendously, and they have different purposes. We are in a new landscape entirely, and this self-publishing is extraordinary in my view. There are a lot of people who publish books because they have something to say, and they want to say it. Well, so we're now in a world where I think the professional crack publishers are doing a wonderful job, but meanwhile, there's a tidal wave of self-publishing that people, I don't think, are adequately
aware
of.
Well, it certainly calls to mind the distinction between intrinsic and extrinsic motivation. My hypothetical person looking for advice on a book offered two extrinsically motivating reasons, fame and money, to write. And your point about there are a number of intrinsically motivated authors for which if the barrier is low enough, they will write and see what audience they can find in their long tail. That calls to mind, I think, a quote from Stephen King, who after his 12th hit book was asked, like, dude, why don't you take a vacation? Like, you know, what makes you keep writing when you've already achieved all this success? And his answer was, what makes you think I have a choice? He's an extremely intrinsically motivated guy, had to write and would, even if he weren't being apparently paid to do it. Ellen, you've been wanting to speak up.
I think a really important factor in this is integration with other works. In other words, publisher published is important for academic works and other works that need to be connected to the whole body of work in their field and to be built off on by the same people who are writing books with them and so forth. And if the book wants to be part of a body of work, it should be publisher published, because the self-published stuff tends to be just individual silos of stuff. But I think another aspect
of this. Just quickly though, what's an example of a body of work would be what? Do you mean in a single anthology, or you mean in a series that a publisher does?
Or computational neuroscience, the whole field. If you publish by a publisher with an expertise and a list in that discipline, then you're going to go directly to the right audience for the work. You're going to have your work discovered by the right people traveling in the right conversational
paths. A form of curation that isn't relying on an individual library to do it, but it's happening on the publishing end, that in academic circles, I think you're making the case for, and it is an additional reason, apart from the tenure committee seemed to need it, as to why you might want to do that. I'm just wondering, though, where in your former Houghton Mifflin, Houghton? Who knew? News you can use? Your Houghton.
Houghton.
All right.
Here.
I'm going to think Santa. It's like ho, ho, ho. Okay.
Houghton Library.
Houghton Library. And here I've been going to the Houghton Library all this time. Okay. So ho, ho, ho. Houghton Mifflin wearing that hat. What about the trade side of things when it's not really part of that kind of systematized knowledge you're speaking of?
I think it's that career path of the unknown writer up to the very successful established writer. Once you're completely known and it's just the next book, your next book is available, that's all you need to tell anybody, and you're done, then you're not going to need a publisher.
But that's fascinating. You're saying the people who need the Houghton Mifflins of the world are the undiscovered people
Absolutely.
To take a ticket to that lottery rather than trying their hand at the social media sort of thing. Rachel, you've been wanting to speak to this.
Oh, well, yeah, I was going to say that I think there's a, in the emphasis on credentialing, there can be forgetfulness about research and other kinds of things that that academic presses and trade publishing houses and magazines with their fact-checking departments provide. And that's a kind of, part of the reason I want more open source materials is that it's very good for research. Like, I really can't read everything I need to read unless I can get access to people's libraries and to materials. And I think that that's a funny stress in the academic world that the very people who do the most research and are most committed to research are hampered by not being able to get access to one another's work.
And I just quickly on that, we've heard Alison saying they're experimenting now very much with at least an open access monograph series. Ellen, any news on open access from MIT?
We're regularly experimenting with it.
All right, that sounds, stay tuned is the,
yes.
Okay, sorry, Rachel, you were saying.
But self-publishing, then you don't have the advantage of a fact-checking department, a copy editing department, that kind of background. And it means that those books, it's hard to know exactly how seriously to take them. If somebody makes a discovery and they publish the book themselves, but they don't go through one of these peer review processes or through the process of being edited and forced to be checked or through the legal department of Random House or whatever else my book maybe goes through, then when I go to read that book online, I don't know how to think about its research.
Now, I guess I'm familiar with the kind of fact-checking a publisher, especially a trade publisher, might be doing, looking for libel.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, read each sentence and figure out who would sue for what.
Yeah.
But the kind of fact-checking that has to do with truth, maybe, Sophia, you have experience with this. Did your book go through peer review, and what's that like? How intensive is the scrutiny?
I have a few things to say about that. One is that I think we need to disaggregate the value of peer review and a good editor from the value of marketing and sales. Those are two separate domains. And even if you think about it historically, peer review existed long before copyright did, right? Peer review is something that happened in the Royal Society, whereas copyright is what, help me out, 1710?
1710.
Yeah.
The Royal Society is like 1499.
No.
17th century.
17th century.
I've not been watching enough Doctor Who episodes to get
Clearly
it straight.
Not.
Okay. I was busy studying in Houghton Mifflin.
My point is there's room for peer review without copyright. It's existed before it could potentially exist again.
Yes.
And I could say a little bit about how the ecology of academia would have to change to make room for that, but your question was more about the experience of peer review. I was lucky, not just in the book, but in articles I've written, to have very good experiences with peer review. With the book, it was submitted to 4 people for review, and I got comments. Obviously, it was an anonymous review, so I don't know who it was, but from people in multiple disciplines who were able to keep me in line in terms of style and fact and argumentation, things like that. That being said, I would say I got better advice by running book workshops on my own and inviting colleagues and giving them a lot of coffee. It's true.
So Authors Alliance could have a fund for that, or even a pairing up sort of service to do a sort of thing. But it's still an idea of peer review that has a clear demarcation before and after publishing.
Yes.
I wonder, is it worth it to open up that wormy can around, well, what if you just sort of iterate and publish a little bit and get peer review called reaction with an understanding that you'll change as you go? I think for defamation, that's probably not the best idea. But for things that have to do with accuracy, better to expose it and then just come out with iterative versions of the book? Or do you want to be done with it, have it out the door, well checked, that's that?
I mean, for purposes of scholarly legitimacy, you want it to be pretty cooked by the time people start reading it, right, in the wider audience. So
I prefer my scholarship medium rare.
I'm sure you do. No, I don't think that model would work, at least not now.
Has the microphone found a new home, wherever it is? Yes, sir.
Right here. I'm Mark Eddington, and I'm trying to start a press at Amherst College. And we're committed to the idea of being an open access press from the beginning. So the first thing I want to say, in defense of Ellen Faran, she published the book Open Access. And it's available open access, right there it is, right. So
you wrote the book on open access, so.
I want to try to tie together two things that I've heard. And Alison, I thought you got it exactly right, that the OA conversation is really a conversation about revenue and where we're going to locate the necessary cost of producing quality work. I think that's exactly right. But I want to try to tie that together with Sophia's necessary concern about prestige. Because my worry is that where we're headed is into creating a two-track system for scholarly communication. And that, in fact, by trying to open up the world for authors who only want impact, and I want to sign up for being the very first press that comes to the Authors Alliance to ask for consulting on our authors' contracts. But by doing that, we're actually solidifying the position of the top-tier publishers with prestige, at least in the monograph world. Mm-hmm. Is that right? Is it a problem? Is there a way to address that issue? Because I'd like to break up that prestige. I'd like to imagine that we actually read the books to understand their value and not just look at the brand.
So, wonderful question. And of course, the zeroth question is, here's a guy starting an academic press in 2014.
Yeah. Almost as crazy as starting a bookshop. No, they are actually coming back, which is great news. Independent bookstores are making something of a comeback. Anyway, to go directly to that question, I think that is the real risk. And you know, one of the reasons I have spent so much time out on campuses over the last 6 months talking not just to faculty and librarians, but to a whole range of people on the administration side, is to try and understand that issue. I don't think we have the perfect answer to that. And the way we are addressing it as we launch our program is, first thing, we're appointing an advisory board for the program, and we are trying to get a lot of very big names on the faculty side, on the library side, on people who've been publicly in favor of open access as one way of doing that up front. There are some open access initiatives that have focused purely on first books. We're not doing that. We're interested in publishing anything open access. I think for us to do that successfully, it's critical for us to publish recognized scholars up front. So one of the things our editors are focused on right now is going to sort of our marquee big name authors and trying to get them to commit to a book in the program. I think those two things alone will help us at launch, that we have recognized names who have decided to publish this way. We just completed about a few weeks ago a survey of faculty in the humanities and social sciences in the US. We got nearly 1,000 responses. So I think it's a pretty good response. And you know, the responses from how authors are thinking about it vary from what I would guess a pretty senior faculty who say, I would never consider publishing in this way, and that's fine. Not everybody has to. Then there are people at the other end who want to know when they can submit a proposal. And then there are a lot of people in the middle who are really intrigued by the model. There's a lot they like about the model, but their fear is, who pays for it? And what is my tenure committee going to say? And so that is the question. So to some extent, you know, for us, there's an advantage and a disadvantage of being on kind of something at the leading edge with this. But I think the landscape's going to look very different in a few years' time as a lot more people start heading down the same road.
Let's take one last question and then wrap up. And Pam, you were going to say something real
quick? So I actually had a similar kind of experience working with the Berkeley Technology Law Journal at my law school. So it was one of a lot of secondary journals that focused on some law and technology issues. And what we did is we did an annual symposium, and we got every person in the law and technology field who had a big name to come give a talk, write a paper in it, and now people are placing their tenure pieces in that journal. And I think that that's actually a model that can scale. So you get some good people who are willing to do these presses, then everybody else feels more comfortable doing that. And given that there's so much talent out there, it seems to me that there isn't just an opportunity for UC Press and MIT, but a press presses, especially if you can develop a kind of specialized expertise that would then mean that if you can kind of get some big names in this space, then that can be a place where people think their tenure pieces really should be. I would say that if I'm kind of trying to talk about what the long-term agenda of the Authors Alliance is, it is in part to speak to those provosts and the tenure committee type people to help develop more fluidity in judgment about break that prestige thing to some degree.
Yes. And of course, your story about the Berkeley Technology Law Journal is a reminder that law reviews and legal scholarship are all student-run, totally different economic structure, cultural structure, social structure, sometimes to the snickering of other fields, but potentially an amazing possibility for leadership, since it's not nearly as locked into a structure. These are our students. We can be like, hey, would you like to run it a different way? They're like, why not? If I have time before my exam, I'll do that. Last question. Yes.
Hi, my name is Ingrid Norton. I recently traded life as an impoverished freelance writer for life as an impoverished grad student here.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
We have a big panel, but no banker on the panel to tell you that you shouldn't do that.
Well, good. And I wanted to ask some of your thoughts, both on what a future copyright law that's more integrated with the digital world looks like, and also about the current structure of the web and Google in particular, and how, both from the perspective of writers and periodicals and publishers, there's often a disconnect between getting the widest audience and getting compensation and monetizing things.
I love how the final questions are like, please discuss the entire situation. I would totally respect that, and we're going to let the panel try to weigh in on both of those issues. On the structure of future copyright law, of course, Pam is a natural to go to, but before we hear from Pam, Mark, I'm curious on the practitioner's perspective. Are there any obvious things that if you could just type a few lines into or delete from Title 17 of the U.S. Code and its corresponding articles elsewhere in the world, what would you do?
Well, the Copyright Act could be open access, and we could all make changes like Wikipedia. I just want to say briefly a word that one constituency that's really important are authors and creators of all kinds, including musicians, who aren't academics or professors, tenured or untenured, who aren't lawyers, who don't have trust funds, and how do we have an economic system that allows them to be full-time professional writers and didn't, like Stephen King, brilliantly work in the old system. I don't think copyright is the issue here. It is more in music. I think the structural issues, to answer your question a little indirectly at first, is with Amazon, the reduction in physical bookstores where you can't decide to buy a children's book from a tactile sense, where everything looks the same on the screen. I think the forces are less about, in publishing, are less about copyright than they are in some other media. That being said, I think what Pam mentioned, and the Copyright Office floated a couple of days more than a year ago, of a small claims court, which would be an administrative body to handle copyright disputes. I think one number was under $30,000 in damage, to be a limit like small claims court, is a really good idea. I think
you don't worry that supply would create demand and that a bunch of stuff that didn't result in litigation before at all would now result, I guess that's the feature, not the bug from your point of view?
Both.
Yeah.
I think a lot of disputes that people decide that they can't afford a lawyer, can't get a pro bono lawyer,
yes,
like the Farias Clinic at Stanford, will say, well, gee, I'll forego the fact that it might be a $50,000 claim and go with this administrative body. I think that would be a fundamentally wonderful claim because there are so many copyright violations that don't justify full federal court litigation and all the machinery and all the expense, not just lawyers, court reporters, discovery, that go way beyond that. So I think an administrative tribunal to handle so-called small claims would be a fantastic change. So if I could make one, I think that would be. Second, I think the DMCA, the Digital Millennium Copyright Act, that deals with trying to remove content that's infringing. We've learned a lot since it was enacted. I think that could use some streamlining. So if I could take a pen to the Copyright Act, those would be the changes. But I really worry about the individual creator, how he or she will build a career when I see, particularly in music, which got hit first by all of these changes, you see very talented musicians who cannot afford to be professional musicians. And if authors can't build their career through an economic system that rewards them, what are we all doing here? Because open access is fantastic, but it's not everything, and it's not necessarily going to guarantee a likelihood of some kind of income. I think that's a really serious issue.
Got it. As I move down to Pam for her view on the copyright question, is there anybody that wants to weigh in on the second piece, which was Google scared, question mark? And I was surprised it wasn't Amazon scared, and if anybody's taken sides or bets on the Hachette controversy. Is it Hachette or Hachette? it's Hachette, isn't
it? It's pronounced Houghton.
What?
Houghton.
Sorry.
Well, just interestingly, yes. On that point, there are a couple of large publishers, including Simon & Schuster, who have just reached a deal with Amazon. So I'm not, you know.
So your advice is sell Hachette.
No, what's in those deals is, of course, not known to anyone.
Yes.
But the fact that Amazon has managed to get a couple of big publishers to sign on.
Yes.
I think, you know, going back to the leverage question, it increases their leverage. For small publishers like us right now, they won't even talk to us. So they clearly want to get the big guys sewn up, and then they come to us, and we have no choice at that point.
Got it. Any other thoughts on the Google-Amazon thing before we turn to Pam on the copyright piece and then break for the remainder of the refreshments?
Hachette is also a big, tough player, and it's too easy to see Amazon as the bad guy and Hachette as the good guy. We live in a real world of tremendous clashing economic interests.
Yes.
But Amazon, when, as you say, what is it, 60% of your sales go
over
through
40,
Amazon?
Yes, you know,
or 40. I mean, every publishing house I've known is being squeezed very hard by Amazon. Mm. And that's part of, I think, the general transformation of the whole world of books that we're living through right now.
Got it. Pam, any quick thoughts on the future of copyright?
So future of copyright is actually something I've spent pretty much my whole professional career thinking about. And I was delighted, actually, when Maria Pallante announced an initiative for a next great copyright act. I haven't seen a version coming out of her yet, so we'll see. But one of the things that she did, that she said that I thought was really promising, is to say copyright law should be something that we could all read, I mean, and understand. So if I could do one thing to make copyright better, it would be make it more comprehensible so that people could actually read the statute, really understand the kind of normative underpinnings of it, and so that would breed, I think, more respect for copyright and would make it more effective. Authors, I think, would feel more empowered to know what they can and can't do, what protections are built into the copyright law for them. And I'm all for attribution right. I think that it's long overdue for U.S. law to recognize attribution interests. And so that's one of the other things that's part of our agenda. But I'm actually trying to write a next great copyright act that's comprehensible. I actually testified before Congress about a year and a half ago, and I held up during my testimony a pamphlet, the 20-page copyright law that some people in Europe, some European professionals had written, and I said, you see, it's possible. Okay, you don't have to have 300 pages. You can actually do it in, you know, 20. And the congressman said, could you do that for us? And I said, sure. So by the time I got home, my husband said, okay, you better get started. So I'm working on it. It's going to take a little while, but I think that that's actually something that would really be positive. Maria sort of announced that she wanted to do that too, but I think there are lots of pressures that make it harder for her to do than for someone like me to do, and so an author-friendly copyright law would actually be a really good idea.
Well, surely if we didn't already have the law we have, we would not be inventing it. And
this is not one, right, if you had your choice,
right.
This is not the one you
would
adopt.
And it may even be if we didn't have the publishing ecosystem we already have, we probably wouldn't invent it just like we see it. and part of this discussion and this organization appears to be to really give a fresh look to where we'd like to see things go rather than sort of hiding under the desk and waiting to see what happens next.
So I want to introduce Mike Wolf, who's the executive director of the Authors Alliance here. He has t-shirts and good stickers.
Are the t-shirts open access or are they for a fee?
I think we have
limited supply, so they're in that corner beeline over there.
Yeah, and
this Mike, is what markets are for. Oh, you're right. Okay, that sounds good.
And Mike won't forgive me if I don't say we're a membership organization, and we would welcome your joining us. You don't have to pay anything, although we'd love that. But please. Please at least look at our website and see we're trying to offer useful advice. If there's something that you'd like to see on that site, some advice you'd like to get, please feel free to get in touch with Mike or me because we really want to make this resource to be something that will be helpful to people.
Well, we thank the Office of Scholarly Communication here at Harvard for sponsoring this, and we deeply thank all of our panelists for coming out to talk to us today about this. From Bologna, too. Thank you very much.